Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So today I'm going to discuss regarding the pain pathway, and those people who are watching this video and who haven't subscribed to my channel, please hit the subscribe button so that you keep on getting the updates from the channel. Okay, so the learning objectives for the pain pathway. So first let's understand the definition of pain. Let's see what are the different types of pain, the receptors which carry the pain sensation, what are the type of pain fibers, and then the pathways. There are two pathways, the course of these two pathways and the termination. And at last, I'm going to discuss a very important topic, which is called as endogenous pain suppression system, or it is also called as endogenous analgesic system. Okay, so stay with me for the entire length of the video, so as to understand the concept behind the pain pathway as well as the endogenous pain suppression system. Again, after watching this video, I bet you need not by heart the pain pathway, because if you understand the concepts, the things are going to fall in place. Okay, so without wasting much time, let's start with the definition. So how do we define pain? According to International Association of Pain Study, pain is defined as an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience which is associated with actual or potential tissue damage. So that means the definition is not limiting itself to telling that pain is just an unpleasant sensory experience. Along with that, they have added that it is also an unpleasant emotional experience which is associated with actual or potential tissue damage. Even though pain is unpleasant, but still pain is protective. Why I am telling that the pain is protective? Because it makes our body aware of the damage which is happening. Okay, that's why the pain is also said to be a protective thing for the body. Now let's see the types of pain. I will give you an example. All of you would have pricked your fingers in the hematology laboratory. When you prick your finger, immediately after pricking the finger, you will experience a sharp localizing pain, and this pain subsides within some time. Followed by that, there is the dull lasting and a diffuse kind of a pain. That means pain is having two important components, and that's why there are two types of pain. The pain which you have experienced immediately after pricking the finger is what is called as the fast pain. Okay, and the pain which you experience after some time and which lasts for longer duration of time and it is not that sharp, it is dull and diffuse, that is what is called as slow pain. So we have two types of pain, fast pain and slow pain. So what are the receptors which are carrying this pain sensation? The receptors which carry this pain sensation are called as free nerve endings. Okay, these are also referred to as naked nerve endings, or also called as free nerve endings. Because we have two types of pain, we also have two types of fibers which carry this pain sensation. So let's see what are these two types of fibers which carry this pain sensation. One is called as A delta fiber. Okay, we all have studied the Erlanger and Gasser's classification of the nerve fibers, and the A delta fibers, these are large fibers, these are myelinated fibers, okay, and these are the one which are having very high conduction of velocity, and these are the one which are conveying the fast pain. Okay, and then the second type of fiber is what is called as the C fiber. The C fibers are small fibers diameter wise and they are unmyelinated fibers, and the rate of conduction is less. Okay, and these are the one which are conveying slow pain. So two fibers, A delta fibers which are carrying the fast pain, C fibers which are carrying the slow pain. Similarly, we also have two pain pathways. Okay, the one is called as neospinothalamic pathway, the second one is called as paleospinothalamic pathway. The neospinothalamic pathway is phylogenetically a newer pathway, and this is the one which is carrying the fast pain sensation. The paleospinothalamic pathway is the one which is carrying the slow pain, and this is said to be phylogenetically a older pathways. So we have two types of pain, we have two types of fibers which are carrying the pain, and we have two types of pain pathways. Now let's understand the course and termination of these two types of pain pathways. Okay, so this is a cross section of the spinal cord. Here we can see a delta fibers concerned with fast pain and the C fibers which are concerned with slow pain. Both A delta and C fibers are going to enter into the spinal cord, and they are going to enter into this part of the spinal cord which is called as the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. Okay, and these fibers are the first order neurons. So as soon as the A delta fibers are entering into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, here in this diagram we can see that they are terminating in the lamina 1. The lamina 1 is also called as lamina marginalis. Now the first order neurons of the C fibers are going to terminate in lamina 2 and the lamina 3. Lamina 2 and 3 combinedly are called as substantia gelatinosa. So that means the A delta fibers are terminating in lamina 1 of the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, and the C fibers are terminating in lamina 2 and 3 of the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. These are the first order neurons. Now what is going to happen? The second order neurons from these laminae are going to cross over to the opposite side, and they are going to run upwards in what is called as anterolateral pathways. The fast fibers, which are nothing but our A delta fibers, are going to occupy the medial part of the anterolateral pathway, and the slow C fibers are going to occupy the lateral part of the anterolateral pathway. Crystal clear. Now next let's see what is going to happen. The A delta fibers are going to release a neurotransmitter at this synapse which is occurring between the first and the second order neurons, and the A delta fibers are going to release a neurotransmitter which is called as glutamate. Okay, similarly the C fibers are also going to release a neurotransmitter, and the neurotransmitter which is released by the C fibers is called as substance P. A delta releases glutamate, C fibers release substance P. And this synapse which is occurring between the first and the second order neurons at the level of the spinal cord, in the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, in the lamina 1, 2 and 3, is also referred to as gate. Why I am calling it as gate is because when the first order neuron releases the neurotransmitter, only then the pain transmission is going to go to the upper parts of the nervous system. But if there is something which is not allowing the release of this neurotransmitter, then the pain transmission is going to be suppressed. So when there is free flow of the neurotransmitter or release of the neurotransmitter is occurring from first order to second order neuron, we say that the gate is open. But because of some reason, because of some inhibition of this synapse between the first and the second order neuron, let's say the neurotransmitter release is reduced or it is entirely stopped, then I say the gate is modulated or the gate is stopped. That's why this synapse is very important, and this synapse is referred to as gate. Remember this point, because this point I will be using when I will be dealing with the endogenous pain suppression system. I hope this is crystal clear till now. Next, let's go ahead with the course. In this diagram here, you can see this green color line, what you are seeing, this is the one which represents the neospinothalamic pathway, and the yellow color line, what you are seeing, is the one which is representing the paleospinothalamic pathway. The second order neurons, somewhere from here, arising from the neospinothalamic pathway, they are going to ascend up, and 99% of the fibers, the second order neurons of the neospinothalamic pathway, are going to terminate in what is called as वेंट्रो पोस्टीरो लैटरल न्यूक्लियस ऑफ द थैलेमस. फ्रॉम हियर द थर्ड ऑर्डर न्यूरॉन्स आर गोइंग टू एमर्ज. दीज आर द थर्ड ऑर्डर न्यूरॉन्स एंड दे आर अल्टीमेटली गोइंग टू टर्मिनेट इन एरिया 3-1-2 ऑफ द कॉर्टेक्स. एरिया 3-1-2 इज नथिंग बट द सोमैटोसेंसरी कॉर्टेक्स. In contrast to these second order neurons, which are belonging to the neospinothalamic pathway, only 1/10 of the fibers of the paleospinothalamic tract are going to terminate in the thalamus. And where they are terminating, remember that they are terminating in the non-specific nucleus of the thalamus. So then what is happening to the remaining majority of the fibers? Remaining majority of the fibers are terminating in the hypothalamus. They terminate in the periaqueductal gray. They terminate in the reticular formation of the brainstem. And they also terminate in what is called as tectum of mesencephalon. So this is where majority of the fibers of the second order neurons belonging to the paleospinothalamic tract are terminating. And again from here, from the thalamus, the third order neurons are emerging and ultimately they are again terminating in the somatosensory cortex. So this is the difference in the course and the pathway of the paleospinothalamic tract and the neospinothalamic tract. Now, if at all you ask me to pin down the differences between these two pathways, like the fast pain pathway and the slow pain pathway, what is it that we are going to write? First and foremost thing is that the fast pain is carried by the A delta fibers. The slow pain is carried by the C fibers. Second thing is that the fast pain is carried by a pathway which is called as neospinothalamic pathway. The slow pain is carried by a pathway which is called as paleospinothalamic pathway. Third difference is that the A delta fibers are going to terminate in lamina 1 of the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, whereas the C fibers are going to terminate in lamina 2 and 3 of the spinal cord, which together are called as substantia gelatinosa. Fourth point here is that the neurotransmitter which is released by the A delta fibers at this level where the first and the second order neurons are undergoing a synapse, the neurotransmitter released here is, yes, glutamate, and the neurotransmitter released here is substance P. Fifth important point is that the second order neurons belonging to the neospinothalamic pathway are going to terminate in the ventro-posterolateral nucleus of the thalamus, and these are 99% of the fibers. Whereas the second order neurons belonging to the paleospinothalamic tract are going to terminate in the thalamus, these are only 1/10 of fibers. The remaining fibers are going to terminate either in the hypothalamus or they are going to terminate in the periaqueductal gray, or they are going to terminate in the reticular formation, or they are going to terminate in the tectum. So this is the difference between the course and the pathway of fast pain and the slow pain. Okay, so now let's see what are the characteristic features of fast pain. The fast pain is the one which is felt very fast, within 0.5 seconds. Few books also say within 0.1 second. And second very important feature is that the fast pain is sharply localized. The point, the time I prick the finger, I can pinpoint and tell from where the pain is originating. But that's not the case with the slow pain. The slow pain is the one which is felt few seconds later. Slow pain is the one which is poorly localized. Slow pain is going to persist for a longer duration of time, maybe because of the substance P's action. Slow pain is the one, very important point, which keeps the person awake. Why does slow pain keeps the person awake? Because the fibers of the slow pain are projecting to what is called as reticular areas of the brain stem. And the reticular area, as we all know, is the one which is helping in keeping a person awake and aware of the things. And the slow pain is also going to evoke an emotional response. Why does it evoke an emotional response? Because the paleospinothalamic tract is projecting to hypothalamus. And this hypothalamus is in turn connected with so many areas of the limbic system. That is why even slow pain is going to evoke an emotional response. So these are the differences between the coarse and different characteristic features of the fast pain and the slow pain. I hope it is crystal clear till now. Next, let's go to something which is very important and which is called as endogenous pain suppression system. Our brain itself is capable of suppressing the incoming pain impulses to the nervous system. The very system of the brain, which has the capacity to suppress the pain which is entering into the nervous system, is what is called as endogenous pain suppression system, or it is also called as analgesia system. And there are three important components of the analgesia system. What are these three important components? The first components are periaqueductal gray and the periventricular nucleus. So these will be our first components. The neurons arising from the periventricular nucleus and the periaqueductal gray, they are going to descend down and they are going to come to this second very important component, which is called as nucleus raphe magnus, or also called as raphe magnus nucleus. So that's our second important component. Now, the second order neurons, these one, which are originating from the raphe magnus nucleus, again they are going to descend down to the spinal cord. So which will be our third component? Our third component is the spinal cord. And where do they descend down? They descend down in the dorsal gray horn of the spinal cord. And they are going to terminate on this interneuron. And what does this interneuron do? This interneuron is in turn terminating on this synapse. What is this synapse? This is the synapse between the first and the second order neuron of the A delta as well as the C fibers, which has entered into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. So how does this system is going to act? This system is going to act via the neurotransmitters which it is going to release. Now, the periventricular nucleus and the periaqueductal gray neurons are going to release a neurotransmitter at the level of the nucleus raphe magnus, and the neurotransmitter which is released here is called as enkephaline, a very important neurotransmitter. This enkephaline is going to stimulate the second order neurons in the nucleus raphe magnus, and these second order neurons are descending down onto the dorsal gray horn of the spinal cord onto these interneurons, and these second order neurons here are going to release one more neurotransmitter which is called as serotonin. Now this serotonin, which is released onto this interneuron, is going to stimulate this interneuron, and this interneuron is again going to release a neurotransmitter which is called as enkephaline. Okay, and this enkephaline is the one which is going to act on that synapse between the first and the second order neuron of the A delta and the C fibers. And this enkephaline is going to cause inhibition of the transmission of the impulses at that level. How does it cause inhibition of the transmission? By both presynaptic inhibition as well as by postsynaptic inhibition. Okay, that's why when I was discussing regarding this synapse between the first and the second order neuron, I told you that this synapse is also called as the gate. And now what is happening to the gate because of the stimulation of this endogenous pain suppression system? The gate is closed, or the gate is modulated. So the neurotransmitter release is decreased, or the neurotransmitter release is stopped. And once the neurotransmitter release is stopped because of release of this neurotransmitter from that interneuron, which is called as the enkephaline, this gate is closed. That's why this endogenous pain suppression system or analgesia system is also called as gate control theory. Gate control theory, because there is something in the brain which is controlling the release of the neurotransmitter at that level, at the level of the spinal cord, and hence it is causing suppression of pain. So remember all the components of the endogenous pain suppression. Not only this, there is one more mechanism by which we can achieve analgesia. And that mechanism is because of the stimulation of fibers which are called as A beta fibers. These A beta fibers are thick myelinated fibers which are carrying the sensation of touch and pressure, and which are going to enter into the spinal cord, again into the dorsal gray horn of the spinal cord. Now, as soon as they are going to enter into the spinal cord, here you can see it is giving a collateral. Again, this collateral is impinging on this synapse between the first and the second order neuron of the A delta and the C fibers. So, whenever I stimulate this A beta fibers, this collateral is going to cause presynaptic inhibition here, and hence it is going to cause reduction in the release of the neurotransmitter. And this is the one which forms the basis of rubbing over an area so as to reduce the pain. So whenever I am rubbing over an area, wherever there is pain, I have headache, what do? I sit like this and I start rubbing over this area. So when I start rubbing over this area, what fibers am I activating? I am activating the A beta fibers. And this is how the A beta fibers are acting to reduce the pain sensation. This is again the mechanism behind application of liniments. This is again the mechanism of acupuncture, which helps in reduction of the pain. And again, this forms the basis of one of the most important therapies which is used for pain reduction, which is called as TENS. What is this TENS? Transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. So when I do a transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, what I am doing? Again, I am activating the A beta fibers. So once these A beta fibers are activated, in this mechanism, they are going to go and suppress the pain. I hope you have understood both how the pain pathways are working as well as how the endogenous analgesia system is working. So just to summarize the entire class, we started off with the definition using the word unpleasant. And we included both the components, sensory component as well as emotional component. Then we saw the types of pain, the fast pain and the slow pain, the receptors, which are the free nerve endings, the type of pain fibers, the A delta fibers and the C. A delta concerned with the fast pain, C concerned with the slow pain. And then we saw the course and termination of two pathways, the neospinothalamic pathway and the paleospinothalamic pathway. Majority of the fibers of the neospinothalamic pathway terminate onto the thalamus, specific nuclei of the thalamus, but the paleospinothalamic tract only 1/10 terminate onto the thalamus, and majority of them terminate onto the hypothalamus, periaqueductal gray, reticular formation and the tectum. And then we saw a very important concept of endogenous pain suppression system. And what are the components of the endogenous pain suppression system? The periaqueductal gray, the periventricular nucleus, the raphe-magnus nucleus, and then the spinal cord. And then we saw what are all the neurotransmitters. Very important is enkephalin, which is going to cause pain suppression by both pre and post synaptic inhibitions. Not only that, we also understood how the stimulation of A beta fibers, which are the pressure and touch fibers, is also going to cause suppression of the pain. I hope this topic was helpful for you and you have understood the topic. If you have understood the topic, hit the like button, share this video as much as possible, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Thank you. See you again.